You're listening to the Screaming Pods Network.
Hope you're ready for the next episode. Hey.
Life. It's funny, isn't it? One second, you're an amoeba. Then, an infant. Then, you're in the parking lot of one of your planet's top-performing metal bands. I'm Sarah Koenig. Journey back with me and my colleagues, Drs. Mike Delaney and Stephanie Crawford, as they excavate minutes 2 and 3 of life's heavy metal parking lot. There's a lot to unpack this week. The Shot on Video Initiative, NPR, and Screaming Pods presents THESOVPODMINIHMPL Part 2. And now, Edward Montgomery, philanthropist, film lover, and home broker.
Hello again, film fans. Edward Montgomery here, checking in to make sure that you are getting the most pleasure possible from our restoration of Heavy Metal Parking Lot. So much of ourselves went into making sure this film looks and sounds as pristine as it does today. But here at Montgomery Video and Mortgage, we are not only satisfied to come up with ways to purify films of the past. We also like to provide supplemental material for the truest of fans.
Are you ready, Steph?
No.
Do you want? What do you mean, no?
No, I'm ready.
All right, very good. All right. Hold on one sec.
Ugh. Are you ready?
I was, but then I did something stupid. All right, here we go. All right, yeah. So we have the drummer on there, and then the bassist, right? They're the two that share the card. That seems pretty fair, right? Okay, that's what you're saying. All right, here's what you need to know about Largo, Maryland, where the movie takes place at at this time in history. So 1986, Largo, Maryland, Steph. They're in the middle of their population boom. Between 1980 and 1990, the population grew 70%. Around this time, there's 8,000 people living in Largo, Maryland. So this was like a very big time in pop culture for Maryland.
Maryland is not generally known for its sharks, but actually a common enough occurrence in the Chesapeake Bay. Bonehead sharks, tiger sharks, hammerhead sharks, and even a great white shark named Mary Lee have all been spotted in Maryland waters. Hi, I'm Malcolm Lawson, a Maryland real estate agent, and that was one of 10 facts that you probably didn't know about Maryland. Here's another one for you. Number 9. Maryland was not always known for the Baltimore Ravens. In fact, starting in 1953, Maryland was known for the Baltimore Colts. This wasn't until the early morning of March 29th, 1984, when the Colts abruptly and without any warning announced that they would be moving to Indianapolis. Still to this day, many Baltimore natives have a strong distaste for the Colts because of this slight. Number 8. Assateague Island near Ocean City, Maryland is home to more than 300 wild ponies that roam free. Legend has it that they originally arrived on the island when a Spanish cargo ship sank off the east coast and the horses swam to shore. Number 7. Maryland used to be shaped like this. Then in 1789, Maryland and Virginia donated 100 square miles of land to form Washington, D.C. In 1846, Virginia took back its donated land and left Washington, D.C. in its current shape. Number 6. Maryland is named after the English queen Henrietta Maria. She was married to Charles, the King of Great Britain, who signed the 1632 charter establishing Maryland as a colony. Number 5. Maryland's flag is based off of the family lines of Lord Baltimore. The black and gold design on the flag is a coat of arms from the Calvert line. The red and white design is the coat of arms of the Crossland line, which is the Lord Baltimore's mother's side. Number 4. Our motto and the state seal was also taken from Lord Baltimore's family crest. Our official state motto translates to manly deeds, womanly words. However, many today find this sexist, and the preferred alternative is strong deeds, gentle words. Maryland is obviously known for its blue crabs, and it also has a thriving oyster industry. At one point, though, Maryland had a thriving scallop industry as well. In 1930, a hurricane struck Maryland and destroyed much of the seagrass in the Chesapeake Bay the scallops used to live in. This, along with the spread of disease, and the Chesapeake scallops were pushed to the brink of extinction. Today, there is a growing effort to reintroduce the scallops into the bay. Number 2, Maryland earned the nickname the Old Line State in the American Revolution during the Battle of Long Island. The Maryland Line successfully held off the advancements of the British long enough for George Washington and the Continental Army to retreat during the first major battle of the war. And the number one fact about Maryland that you probably did not know is that a recent study concluded that 38% of all Maryland crab cakes do not contain Maryland crabs. DNA tests identified 8 non-Maryland crab species in crab cakes sold throughout the state.
Anything else from the first minute?
Well, we get our first look at the parking lot proper right after the Judas Priest montage. We get to see the actual parking lot, and it really whets your appetite. Because if you're not familiar with the legend of this movie, once you see what everyone looks like and like the snapshot of time it is, it's pretty enticing.
It is, and we are going to be describing some of those snapshots here very shortly. And if I'm not mistaken, you made a joke when you called me on the phone. You said that your Nick Cage-o-meter went off. Is he part of this legend, or what don't I know?
Rob says Leonardo DiCaprio, Belinda Carlisle, and Nicolas Cage, and his cousin, Sofia Coppola, were among those he introduced HMPL to. Schaffner says Coppola, Cage's cousin in real life, once came in and requested a batch of, like, 10 copies of the movie to give out as gifts. Source: The Deranged True Story of Heavy Metal Parking Lot, The Citizen Kane of Wasted Teenage Metalness by Dave McKenna for Concourse, March 29th, 2016.
He's just part of everything. He's like the Force, I guess.
Yes. He is the Force. He's part of it. Yes. Absolutely. Let's just press play. So I'm gonna kick this one off because I do want to say that most of minute two we hear that Judas Priest song, "You Got Another Thing Coming," right?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's the only Judas Priest song ever to chart on the top 100 or the Hot 100, whatever Billboard calls it, and it only landed at number 67. But like, I wish and I hope I could find a clip of this for the show. I want to hear Casey Kasem talk about Judas Priest, but I don't think he ever played. Did he play like he did like the top 50, right? Or the top 20? What did he do?
I don't know. I know he was on Saved by the Bell.
Our first finalists, the exciting spandex twins, Kelly Kapowski and AC Slater.
Right, and he's Shaggy.
And he's
right?
Shaggy, yeah. That's pretty much what I know.
Jerry, as long as we're talking to the young people this morning and their canisters and waking mom and dad up and telling them to get to the telephone, there's another character, a cartoon character, that I've played for the past 18 years on the network and in syndication. How many of you know the show Scooby-Doo? Well, there's a character that I play on that show, the sidekick of Scooby-Doo for the past 17 or 18 years, and his name is Shaggy. And Shaggy would like to say a few words to the young people out there, all right?
Go ahead. Are you Shaggy?
I'm Shaggy.
Go ahead, Shaggy.
Shaggy talks like this. The way he talks, Jer. And he's always talking about his good buddy Scoob, his old friend, his old pal, his old dear, dear buddy. And Shaggy would say right now, not all young children are as fortunate as you are. There are some that aren't. And some of them have muscular dystrophy. And there's one way to make sure that we one day find a cure for it. So just like Scoob would say, that's right, Raggy. I'm saying, as Shaggy, pitch in. Get those dimes and those quarters and those pennies. They add up, and they can all make a big, big difference. Your old pal Shaggy and Scooby, too, saying, why don't you do it this morning? And remind Mom and Dad to get to that phone and make their pledge, too, okay? Thank you.
The other quick thing that I want to say about this minute is how everyone at this time period is still, like, so enamored and starstruck when they see someone hold a VHS camera. Like, you... Like, nowadays, we could hold a cell phone up and, you know, we could film incognito. But, you know, of course, back then, you had these things mounted on your shoulders. And these drunk kids all see this. I say kids, but we'll get to that later. But they all see this video camera, and they just want to be, like, right there. And it's kind of fun to see everybody so excited to get recorded. What do you have from this second minute?
The second minute, it's pretty notable for being rock and roll. We get our first power screams that we hear while they're passing by, which I think kind of works into the excitement you brought up. You see a camera, you scream, please God, put that camera on me, because it was definitely a novelty back then. Plus, we get to see Judas Priest tour buses, and they're pretty fucking badass.
They are really good looking tour buses. I was gonna say brushes because they have the airbrushing. What does it say on the back of it? Like classic, or it just had that really cool like neon 80s font to it, where you're like, yeah, man, they're getting some fucking road sodas and road head in that bus right there. lots of good baseball style rock tees, right? We don't get a too many close-ups to see exactly what the shirts say at this moment, but tons of delicious mullets. We do, if we're talking about the mise-en-scene, like how everything is coming together, we do know that there's a police presence. Hello?
Okay, the call just got lost. I'm going to leave the recording on. And something just got knocked over. I guess that's good timing if that was going to happen. Rockin' till the dawn.
I'm hitting stop.
Till the morning. I'm gone.
Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad cause he's brown. Fuck the police.
Yeah, fuck the police.
Fuck the police coming straight from the underground. A young nigger got it bad cause he's brown. Fuck the police.
Yeah, there's a lot of good baseball style rock tees, delicious mullets, police presence, shirts off, beers out. You know, I've done this 3 or 4 times already, so if I don't have this information out there, then there you go. Oh, Steph, hey, hi, can you hit play so we could watch minute 2 to 3? Thank you, Steph, for hitting play.
Yeah.
I'm David Helby, I'm 20 years old. I'm ready to rock.
Don, I'm 13.
Who are you here to see tonight?
Judas Priest!
Judas Priest is the best.
Uh-huh.
Always
Calvin
has
County.
Been, always
Calvin
been.
County,
oh,
I see.
They're gonna show how young people fuck up today.
Hey, I'll be in the Air Force in about 2.5 weeks.
Fucking party! No shit.
All right, what's your name?
Graham, man, like Graham of Dirt and shit.
Yeah. Where are you from? Where are you from?
Well, I'm from fucking the West Coast, man.
You came all the way. All
right, so Stephanie, take it away. What do we get here in minute 2 to 3?
Okay, well, we have one of our first very memorable character set pieces, I would say. We have a handsome young man. He tells us he's 20 years old, and he's with some friends, including a young girl next to him. And she lets us know that she's 13, and then we get a close-up of them kissing. Did you ever find out the age of consent in Maryland, by the way?
The age of consent in Maryland is 16, and it's also of note that Maryland sex laws, to quote the great Beck, the sex laws in Maryland, there's no close age exemption. All right, so no Romeo and Juliet laws. That is what they call it. Although wasn't Romeo and Juliet? They were like 14 and 20. Anyway, whatever.
How old are you?
20.
She's a 17-year-old girl. So we can work this two ways. One, I punch you right in the mouth and you call the police on me.
Dad.
Or two, I just call the cops on you because this is illegal. She's a minor.
We're protected by the Romeo and Juliet laws.
We dated for a little while. I was a sophomore and he was a senior. It's fine.
No, it's not fine.
We've got a pre-existing juvenile foundation relationship. Statute 2705-3.
What? Texas statute?
And I really
Juliet, huh? You know how those two ended up?
No.
Dead.
Yeah, but what that means is that if you're under 16 and you have sex, that's statutory rape. So that means two 15-year-olds could fuck and both get charged with statutory rape. So definitely this guy is up Schitt's Creek. Yeah.
Okay. Can I give you some behind the scenes information I gleaned from the DVD? I had it recorded onto VHS. Does that count? I had it transferred. I went backwards. However, I have the background scoop from the DVD, which I had transferred backwards on a VHS, so it's okay. It's kosher. They caught up with a few of the people who appeared in the documentary. This blonde guy was one of them, and he's still rocking. He's super enthusiastic. He's in a band, and the band prepared a song that's about the heavy metal parking lot movie. And you can, the filmmaker's like, oh, this is great, we're catching up. But you can tell they're just chomping at the bit to ask him about the jailbait. So they're like, so was she your girlfriend? Immediately he said, no. She was the daughter of, like, my dentist. And she lived nearby, and she went to the school I used to, and she had tickets for Judas Priest. I said, yeah, I'd go, but, like, she wasn't my girlfriend. So, I guess it depends on how trustworthy you think this guy is. I'm going to take him at his word just so I'm not creeped out. But he says they're still friends and everything, so.
Yeah, it would be significantly less shocking, though, because he would be, what, like 50 at this time, and then she'd be like 43. So, yeah, it wouldn't hit the same way. But, yeah. I don't believe him.
Yeah, that's probably a good call.
What else do we have from minute 2 to 3? You know what? I feel like the people that went in the concert early, I feel like they don't look like everybody else that's hanging out in the parking lot. They look like they're there for like Duran Duran or The Fix or something. Like they're going to listen to Reach the Beach, you know? They don't look like the heavy metalers. So they,
yeah,
definitely not pre-partying, those people sneaking inside. And I also want to say at this time, it's weird to see how many, because this is, this is 1986? How many people are, like, unironically wearing, like, Rolling Stones or, like, Led Zeppelin or like Grateful Dead, like to a heavy metal rock show like this, because the Stones were not cool at this time.
The Stones, more like the Rolling Boners. Fuck this band. They are a shitty hard rock band who formed in 1962. What the fuck? What a bunch of old geezers. Canada, let me talk about the Femmes. Oh my fucking god. The Femmes are butts for idiots who can't take opinions for shit. Fuck the Rolling Stones and fuck Bon Jovi.
Right. No. So these are like hardcore rock and rollers, and maybe it's even fucking Laundry Day. Like nowadays you could buy a Rolling Stone shirt from Target or wherever, but these people are in it to win it. Hit play. Well, yes.
Well, kind of.
No?
Well, it was a transitionary period for Judas Priest. So you did have some heavy metal people, definitely, but their game played on the radio. The album was more approachable, it was a little catchier, so you had more mainstream people. You had some more party people, some people who looked vaguely Duran Duran, as and some may call them.
Who's Dokken pulling in at this point? Because we should mention, too, that Dokken is the special guest, the opener, or whatever, for the show.
Well, if I'm judging it by Hemel Parking Lot alone, it's the girls.
Dokken.
Girls seem to appreciate Dokken
pulling
the
in
most.
The tail. That is true. When they ask the boys or the dudes or whatever, the penist creatures, they're all like, priest, priest.
It's like 50-50.
You think so?
It's like, dogs all right. Yeah, a few of them said they were all right.
They were all right.
And some said they did.
All right, hit play for minutes 3 and 4, please.
Hope you're ready for the next episode. Hey.
On the next THESOVPODMINIHMPL Part 3. Who Killed Laura Palmer was water cooler in 1990. In 2018, coolers are buzzing with this query. What happens next? I'm Sarah Koenig. You're not. Fuck you. 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 I'm Sarah Koenig. You're not. Fuck you.
And now,